I truly believe that the legislation that was passed unanimously by Parliament with very little debate is one of the most damaging pieces of legislation for India's, millions of India's most vulnerable children and their futures. But our indifference to even the questions that that we must ask reflect the kind of society we have become. And so I'm really happy that we're having this discussion today. This has been a tumultuous year in some ways, and it really began with a young man in Hyderabad University taking his life. And I think something that he wrote in his first and last letter to the world, as he described it, is at the heart of what we are going to discuss today. When he said, "I could not escape the fatal accident of my birth," I believe that it is perhaps the greatest indictment of what we have achieved and not achieved in these 70 years, that for the majority of India's children, they are unable to escape the fatal accident of their birth. The accident of their birth determines whether they'll live at all, whether they'll survive their childhood, whether what kind of nutrition they'll have access to, whether they'll have an education, what kind of education, how long will they be able to study, and what jobs are open to them and what jobs are not, and so on, and what kind of work they'll do, what kind of, if they reach old age, what kind of old age will they spend. All of this is still determined by the accident of birth. And tragically, for millions of children, that accident is a fatal one, and it continues to be so. And the only thing that could change that destiny of birth would be if we had resolved and implemented the idea of that everything else can come later, but every child, regardless of the accident of her birth, must have equal chances in childhood. And the Right to Education Act did say, with all its limitations, that a child between 6 and 14 would have the right to free and compulsory education. But it never said the right to free and compulsory equal education. And so in any case, wherever you are born, the accident of where you are born, the education system today completely mirrors it. And so the children of the very rich would go abroad, the children slightly less rich would study in the elite schools and so on. And coming down, and if you're a poor person in a village, you'd be studying in a school with, if at all, with one teacher for five classes and with all. And then there's a whole segment of children who would never get the chance to study. And we have not done nearly enough. I mean, we've done too little to change this reality. And we must remember that the countries that that we set up as role models, both the countries in the north, the centers of global capital, but also the fast growing economies that preceded us, South Korea, China, all of them did go for market growth, but on a foundation of universal quality education for all. And we haven't done that. In fact, I think if you look around, what India is trying to do has no parallel in the world, because we are trying to achieve and sustain this pace of economic growth on the most unequal foundations, without public investments in education. So what happens to children who are not born in school? What are the life chances they have? Many of us have a sense that in popular discussion, people say child labor is unfortunate. As long as India is at work, families have no option to make the same decision. So in a sense, the rationalization, the rationale for the principal rationale of child labor has always been that as long as there is poverty, there will be child labor. I think what child rights activists have helped us see is actually that the reverse is true. As long as there is child labor, poverty will be. Let me explain. Right here in Jammu, we had the whole country got to know of many very charismatic countries with sports or justice and truth with so much passion. What is really attractive about these countries is also their stories. And the lowest paid government employee of all. This Kathmandu worker is like the lowest paid, but her helper is really human working. And her son is the president of the game students in the Southeast, captured the imagination of millions of people across the country. This Bhendra's own story is his story, and I was reading more and more about him. And I'm sure about his mother, who picked up that as a little girl, the daughter of a construction workers. And she's a prophet in a sense when she does a domestic help, and then her son starts growing up and he gets a domestic, and how he went out, he used to work with his hands and work with construction sites, but still saw the good sense of an education. And we saw somebody who could have become a science writer like Parsifal, as he did. And when that letter went around, Parsifal's wife read that letter, and she discovered that he's written is a reminder of what human civilization loses in terms of loss of potential because of taking supplies. So, what I'm trying to say is that these young people have struggled against enormous poverty, and some domestic helper or family helper be able to display the kind of quality of heart and mind and leadership that they display is only possible because of the chance to start. With all the other languages, we got a chance to learn. And the importance of public education right from this school, as you reminded us, to universities, is something for our children. When I say child labor is not the result of poverty, but its cause, a child who remains in labor rather than in school will have no option except to do the work at home. Mothers are standing, families are standing, but that's all that I'm doing, is getting jobbing and start doing that. My father is a
out of that cycle is that despite all the efforts, my family and the school ensures that I get the chance to have a full education. That's what becomes the position that we government promise. Within that, and one other thing that I think we need to remember is that for every child who works, there is one adult who is deprived of work. And so if you really ensure that no child is in work, you will ensure that that number of adults will be in work, you will be then able to take care of their children and ensure that they don't have work. So I think that's the second thing I want to say is that the argument that rationalizes child labor because of poverty needs to be challenging their government side. So the law in India, incredibly, and to give the debates, it is precisely this rationalization that I was speaking about, which led to people saying that India is a poor country and you have to, child labor is a guarantee, you have to accept it, and you will be accepted in too many decades. The only exception was that there was no ban on children working above the age of 30 so far. And the ban on children working under the age of 40 with no lower limit achievement, or that they cannot work in hazardous occupations. And I think that it was a long time for people to, agile examples, push hazardous. And I think it was only in 2008 that domestic work was recognized and recalled. So domestic child labor actually became illegal only as recently as 2008. This list kept expanding, and we had about 33 categories and processes of work that were recognized to be hazardous for a child. And for that, a large amount of child work gradually started to come in number of children. But as I said, child labor itself was not illegal, and child labor of any kind, hazardous or non-hazardous, was permitted for a child after the age of 18. Now, the agitation, the demand was growing, and to have a right to education, and how can you then have any child in the labor of the world? People like Chandra Sinha say that a child who is not in school is child labor. So when you have census definition, they say so many children are in school, so many children are in labor, and then what about the other children? And sometimes they call the nowhere children. But you have to recognize that the nowhere child is in work, they are working in the house with the other kids. And so, the demand was that no, now all child labor, after the 2009 amendment, there is no way that child labor can continue to be utilized. We have a president of the government which I find remembered for many things. As I think, in second year anniversary, there are many examples. One of the things that we remember as a thing is one of, as a republic of lies, in a sense. Because whatever you say that you do nothing for farmers, you say this is a farmer's budget, we do so much for farmers, you increase the morale just for farmers, then you look carefully, you find all the plans, then you shift it one hand to another hand. Actually, there's no greater allocation, and so on and so forth for a number of things. So here, once again, what we were told is that we are actually now fully banning child labor after the age of 14, and for children between 14 and 18, we are restricting child labor only to non-hazardous occupations. Now, those are things that one needs to probably celebrate and say that's wonderful. But then once you've done that, you have put in two so caveats which turn on the head what you said and set out to do. So instead of, they said, all child labor is bad except the working of children in what are described as family enterprises. Now, family enterprises is a term that they define it as work, which is in which father, mother, brother, sister, fathers, brother and sister, mother, brother and sister, work that is organized around by them is a family enterprise. Now, there are studies which show that something like about 80% of work by children is always within, doing farm work, doing in the house, a good range of activities which are actually out of home production. But even now, you know, say there's a dhaba owned by your uncle, and uncle has a very large definition in the Indian days. A child working in a dhaba, for instance, is legal because it's a family enterprise. And so you go back to, you know, and by stretching it, your mother's investment health, and you go down along with that, like her, clean the floors, protecting your family in its work. And so it's stretching. And so that's one thing that they do. And the second, they said, except in hazardous occupations. But it could have been fine then. But in hazardous occupations, the list of equity is about 3, of which they have mining and dealing with explosives. And the third is hazardous occupations as defined in the factories. Now again, I find that, to my mind, as much as I can understand, it's simply double thing. Obviously, if something is hazardous for an adult, it's certainly hazardous for a child. I mean, the whole business about having a set of places is to recognize that in childhood we cannot do things that an adult might be able to do. So in a sense, it's not a list of three, but it's actually a list of two, as far as I'm concerned. That is the thing. So in a sense, you open the door as well. And so for children above the age of 40, you said, they cannot work in hazardous occupation, but then the meaning of hazardous occupation is then narrowed down so much that it again mostly uses you. And this is another example of showing that you're doing one thing but actually doing something which is exactly the opposite. And there are two more points I'd like to make, and then I'll ask you to show the comment. One of them is, people argue, and we have many arguments, that people say, but what is wrong with a child learning the trade of a father or mother? To my mind, if you take that argument forward, you're basically saying what's wrong with us. And then, you know, why should, you know, say, a potter's child must learn from the weaver's child must learn from the why should a potter's child have to learn from the why can't she go forward in life to do? Why can't a potter's child go forward? Why can't be a scavenger's child, be a scientist, why can't a canner's child be a philosopher? And why can't a middle-class person feel a talent for working with her hands? So by saying that this amendment to the law is justified because a child should have to learn a parent's occupation, is something particularly in the history of current development that we have that is simply a rationalization of the other class. We might argue then that no, but working with one's hands is part of a good education. I can't agree with you more. But then everybody should be working with their hands. And if anything, a child of the world, whatever you do will be working with the hands. It's maybe the children of the day, you should tell us how to work. If you believe that working is a good part of education. So I think that's another argument that we need to challenge and to do. The last thing that I can say is that it is not by accident that this is being promoted in a context where markets are the goal and the government is the ultimate objective. I would like to remember the nationalizing council and believe that this general discussion has begun. And I cannot believe it, but we had officials who actually came in right and put it in writing that if we ban child labor, India's economic growth will be affected. And they say that children, India's advantage is that we have children who are able to produce at lower cost, and therefore our products will be cheaper, and therefore we have the product advantage. And they actually said this. And I found it hard to believe and say that you really think that India's economic growth has been tapped on the shoulders of thin shoulders of working children. But that is very, and I could see that. See what has happened in the last 20 years, it seemed almost the net of job is growing. The few jobs that are being created are largely not in the formal sector. The factory floor is more or less one of the history, where you have workers working together with some organized champions, protected in some way, or at least organized to phenomena that is under the capital wants to be submissive and uncreative and extremely motivated to work. And they've accomplished it through increased capitalization of work. And so the big brands absorb themselves in any responsibility to the person who's actually working, because that person is not their employee when they work. And it's not their process or a factory is done by them. But that work is then subcontracted and subcontracted. And it's somewhere in either a staff or a community, largely very poor women working 16 hours, 18 hours trying to do those tasks. And then she in many cases is being exploited, but then she has to fulfill her quota and target and try to earn some money. Who is going to help her except panchayat and me? Another defense is that the law is fine because they're saying it's only after school, so they are not stopping the child from studying. So the child is enrolled at the time. First we know today 99% children are enrolled officially. But some of them are actually in school. So once again that becomes an advantage. Even if a child is in school, if a child of a more educated person comes home and then rest days, watch a television, has some game, some children put their children, does homework and goes to sleep. And another child comes home and gets up working, and then goes to sleep. There's obviously what we're talking about in the jobs. This is part of both the development of imagination of how they would like the world to turn to a large reserve army of submissive unorganized workers. I was in Tamil Nadu, where spinning mills had largely aggressive girls. The scheme was called Spamini Nadu, where they would come in at the age of 13 or 14, and they put them in large factories, which are like jails. These girls stayed there for years, and they were 50 days a week in a year, and were about 60 days, 18 hours a day. And they were told that the homeless were Last year,